So thank you so much, Mani, and thank you so much, everyone, for coming here today. As Mani said, this is the first time that I'll be joining you here, and I'm really excited about it. And I so much appreciate reading in the chat where everybody's coming from, and also seeing how you're sending greetings to each other. So it really feels like stepping into a very warm space and a very committed space. And I just appreciate that so much. Before I say a little bit more about what we'll be doing today, I think it's good for us maybe all together also just to take a moment to really acknowledge that here we are, 60 plus people, and that we are coming in from different places on the earth. I'm based here in Europe, outside Copenhagen. I saw others from Europe, from Germany, from UK. I saw people from the US, many, many different places in the US and Canada and other places. So just this notion that we're coming in from many different places and there's something that's calling us. And also acknowledging that for some of us, it's relatively late in the evening. For some, it's early in the morning. Maybe for some, it's midday. So we come in from different activities. We come in having different experiences in our hearts and in our minds. So you just take a moment to notice what it is that each and every one of us is bringing here today. To checking in with ourselves. And just seeing how the body is. Seeing the level of energy and what's on our heart. And also seeing how the mind is. And if you like, you may want to take a few deeper breaths. And just having this sense of inviting the mind and the body to relax. And then if you like, if your eyes have been closed, maybe you want to open them. And just keeping connected to yourself, to your inner state. And at the same time, also an invitation to connect with others here. So just this awareness of here we are sitting together. And perhaps if you look at a few different frames, you see different people, you get an opportunity to connect with them, to feel them. And just see how that is for you. And maybe notice if something changes in the quality of your experience when you open to others and you see others. Not that it has to, not that there's something that's right or something that's wrong. But maybe just appreciate this experience of sitting down together here. And some we can see, and some we cannot see, but we can see people's name and we can know that they're there. And everyone can be included. Okay, thank you so much. So we're coming here today to practice together and also to explore some of the Buddhist teachings. And, you know, community is extremely important when we talk about practice. So we are always in community, right? We're born into community, and for many of us, it's also a place where we're struggling, and it may also be a place where we find a lot of joy and refuge. But when it comes to practice, really having this opportunity to sit down with others who also have this interest like we have is something that is extremely valuable and something that we can really take time to rejoice, take time to appreciate. And Mani, she shared sort of the title for our gathering today, which is Feeling Tone as a Doorway to Awareness, Compassion, and Wisdom. And I gave that title some time ago. And when I was reflecting on it, I thought, oh, I wish that I had tweaked it a little bit and had called it The Courage to Know Feeling Tone as a Doorway. Because there's something about the courage it takes to really turn towards our own experience, like we just did here, turning towards our own inner experience, but also turning towards the experience of coming together as a community, sitting down in a circle, and really being present and seeing each other. And seeing how this really is a doorway to new understanding, how it is a doorway, we could say, in many ways, to healing. And this is what I would like to talk about today. I will invite us first to practice. So we'll be sitting, practicing, and there'll be space for you to practice with the instructions that you already use in your daily life. So part of the practice time will be guided, and some of it will be where we're sitting together in silence. And then after that, I'll be offering some reflections on this topic. And then there will also be an opportunity for us to have an exchange. So I very much look forward to this being a space where we can be interacting. And where hopefully all of us will have an opportunity to feel that we can contribute, and hopefully also that we will have an opportunity that we are receiving something from coming together and being together in this way. So with that being said, I will invite you to, you know, to find a posture that supports you in having a sense of being grounded, having a sense of being present. One of my teachers always says that, you know, there are two main principles for our posture. And one of them is the experience of sitting upright. So we can allow the back to be straight without being stiff. So we have this sense of wakefulness, of presence. And then the other principle is inviting the muscles in the body to be relaxed. And as we are inviting the muscles to relax, we can also allow the mind to relax. So it's all happening in an atmosphere of invitation. We're not demanding anything. You're not forcing anything. But just this sense of right now, there's nothing that I have to do. Right now, I can breathe out and let be. And just open to this experience of sitting here in the middle of my life. So there's this knowing quality. Knows we're sitting here. And as we are sitting, we may feel the body. This experience of awareness resting within the body. This experience of knowing the body, feeling the body. Perhaps the sense of groundedness, contact to the chair, to the floor. feeling how the body is alive, how there's movement, how that comes to expression. Perhaps the sense of the breath. Moving in, moving out. The opening. Taking something in. The releasing. We may experience the stream of changing sensations. Stream of different feelings. Noticing how the mind may be moving. Maybe the mind is very busy, maybe not. But how it may be moving with different thoughts or images. And how it's all part of this streaming of the present moment. How it's all part of sitting here in the middle of our life. And the best we can, holding space for experience to unfold. and just the best we can, resting within this knowing quality. The awareness that's the background to everything we experience. What's being streamed from the body may change. Different sensations, different feelings. And yet there is knowing. The stream of thoughts may change. Some being more pleasant, some maybe not so pleasant. Some in between. And yet, there's still this knowing quality. So the best we can, we can just allow ourselves to rest with this knowing quality. Rest in open awareness, where we're not trying to change anything. Where we don't have to pretend in any way. But the best we can, just allow the stream of experience to unfold. To hold space for our own experience. Okay. So, if you like, maybe take a few seconds to move the body, to adjust your posture. Perhaps move a bit, shake a bit. Okay, so I wanted to begin tonight's talk with, or today's talk. For me, it's night, but I know it's not for everyone. Today's talk with a quote from the Dhammapada. As you may know, the Dhammapada is a collection of 421 verses that is said to go back to the Buddha. And it's a collection of verses that people really throughout centuries has been coming back to again and again as a treasury of wisdom quotes. And the Dhammapada is it's in different chapters, and some of the chapters are by topic and some of the chapters are by other characteristics, what the verses have in common. But the one that I wanted to read from is from chapter 12, and it's called Oneself. And here in this context, it's oneself in a very ordinary way. So it's not the philosophical discussion about self or not self, but it's just the way that we sort of relate to ourselves in a very ordinary way. And it goes like this: if one knew oneself to be precious, one would guard oneself with care. The sage will watch over herself in any part of the night. And this is the verse that I've been coming back to again and again for the last couple of months. And I just think that there's something extremely touching in this very first line where it says, if one knew oneself to be precious. And then continues, one would guard oneself with care. So guarding oneself with care is referring to mindfulness. What it's really saying is that if we really knew ourselves to be precious, then we would live our life with mindfulness. We would live a life with mindfulness at any point in time. So the three parts of the night is referring to the Buddha's awakening when he was sitting under the Bodhi tree and how the night was divided into three different parts where he had three different insights. So I think this is something that's very interesting, isn't it? Because if one knew oneself to be precious, it's almost like it's a different starting point that we sometimes have when we hear the Dharma. Sometimes we start with suffering, but here it's really the suggestion that if we the problem is that we don't really know ourselves to be precious. And I think for me, this experience, I don't know for you what you get in touch with when you hear the word preciousness and ponder this, the opportunity or the possibility of knowing oneself as being precious. So here it's not just understanding intellectually that we may be precious, but it's really like having this embodied experience of it. And for me, it really connects me with what it is that brought me to practice. Because I recall when I started practicing, I very much was in a situation where this wasn't my experience. I felt that I was struggling in different ways. I was a very young mother. I was a single mother. I had, you know, different challenging life circumstances like many other people have. And then I remember that His Holiness the Dalai Lama was coming to Denmark. And a friend of mine asked me if I wanted to come, and I had no idea who he was. I didn't know. It was in the 80s, and, you know, he wasn't as famous as he later became. So I also didn't have any expectations at all. And I remember arriving there and then, you know, seeing someone whom I felt was at very much at home in their own skin. I remember seeing someone where I had this experience that this is a person who is actually okay being themselves. And for me, that was extremely inspiring because I felt this discrepancy. I felt in my own life that I didn't have the experience of being okay. I didn't have the experience of being at ease, of being relaxed at all. I had an experience of struggling to be someone else. I had an experience to, you know, to change in different ways, but not knowing how to do it. And also the experience that I had, you know, that I was trying really hard. And so I think, you know, for some of us, we may have this, we may intuit that things could be different. We may not have the direct experience that we see ourselves as precious, we experience ourselves as precious, but we have this, we can intuit that it could be different. And then we begin to ponder, what would it mean? What would it actually take to see ourselves in a completely different way? And it's a shift in perception. And I think that this is really what the practice is about. And I just love how this verse is starting with this invitation, starting with this opportunity to really look at ourselves and our own situation in a radically different way. And this is an image that we will also see in many different traditions. Sometimes some traditions are talking about how our situation really is a situation where we are like a person who has a diamond, but we do not know that it's a diamond. So we think that it's just a stone covered in mud, right? So we have this experience of being poor, of lacking, of not being who we really would like to be. And the situation isn't that we're actually truly lacking. The situation is that we just don't recognize what we have because we don't know where to look for it, perhaps. And I think one of the ways of looking at practice is to look at practice as an opportunity to really take a thorough look at our own situation. And we can go all the way back to how we arrived in this world, and we can see what it is that's been driving us all the time. We can see what are some of the underlying qualities. And when we do that, one of the things that we begin to see is that underneath everything that we do, there's always been care. There's always been the wish to be at ease. There's always been the wish to do our best. There's always been the wish to avoid suffering. There's always been the wish to be happy. And so we begin to see that even at times when we feel that love is something that's very separate from us, love is something that we are actually lacking, we begin to see that if we look at just going through an ordinary day and see what we do through that day and see what it is that motivates us to do the different things that we do, we begin to see that actually some of these qualities that I wish I had, I actually begin to see that they're there. Today, earlier today, I was out shopping, and one of the things that's very touching when you go into a supermarket is that you see a lot of people who are doing the same, right? But you also see a lot of expressions of care, right? So you could see parents who were out shopping for their kids so that they could make their lunch bags, so that they could give them breakfast, you know, so that they could cook dinner for them and so forth. And you see, oh, that all of that is coming out of care. All of that is actually rooted in love. And in many other ways, we can also see that when we look at what we do, how so much of what we're doing is really motivated by not wanting to suffer. It's really motivated by compassion, this wish not to suffer, and trying our best in so many different ways not to suffer. So there are ways when we pause and we look at our life and we really take a thorough look at everything that's going on and take it and look a little bit deeper, we begin to see some of these qualities that are actually there. We also begin to see many other kinds of qualities. We see, for example, creativity and how throughout our life in so many different ways we are good problem solvers, we are creative, maybe how we have the capacity for appreciation, how we have the capacity to listen, how we have the capacity to solve different problems, to learn new things. So when we look at our life in this way, then we begin to more and more see that, oh yeah, actually, we begin to see the preciousness of our own life. We begin to see the preciousness of our own situation. And then the verse said, if we see the preciousness, then we will live our life with more mindfulness. We will live our life with more care. So out of seeing some of these qualities comes care. So there's a natural connection between seeing some of our qualities and then care. And this care is not just a care that is for ourselves, because when we have this lens and begin to look at our own situation in this way, then we also begin to see that it's the same for others, right? So it's not just, it doesn't just change how we see ourselves, but it also begins to change how we actually see others. And we know from all the studies around nature that what we feel close to is also what we care for. So when we feel close to nature, then there's a natural care that also arises. So there's this link between seeing closely, familiarity, and then care. And so I think that this is just helpful to remember that there are different ways we can look at this sense of preciousness and how we may strengthen it and how we may nourish it. And one of them is in a more, we could say, a more kind of analytical way, where we look at our life through a specific lens and we look at different situations in our life through a specific lens. And that's a very, very valuable way, and it's a way that will definitely change something in our own perception. But there's also another way, or many other ways, and one of them is perhaps a more direct way. And as you may know, there's one of the suttas, the Satipatthana Sutta, which is often referred to as the four foundations of mindfulness. And the Buddha, he begins this specific teaching with a saying where he says, this is the direct path to the purification of beings, for the overcoming of sorrow and lamentation, for the disappearance of dukkha and discontent, for the attainment of the true way, for the realization of nibbana, namely the four satipatthanas. So this is a very clear statement about the path and where it is that it's leading to the overcoming of suffering. And in this particular teaching, the Buddha is talking about liberation, and he's talking about how we can break this cycle of reactivity, this cycle of not really seeing who we are, not really seeing what we are. And the teaching is pointing to how we can be free. And in the teaching, he's talking about four fields of mindfulness, four areas of mindfulness. And the first one is mindfulness of the body. And many of us, we have done a lot of awareness of the body. We've done a lot of mindfulness of the body because it is an extremely important practice. But the next one is mindfulness of what is called feeling tones, or in Pali, Vedana. And so feeling tone is a word that's conveying the immediate call out that we have experiencing every moment of either something being pleasant, something being unpleasant, or something being in between. So for all beings, this is something that we have in common with single-celled animals also, that when we have a system that is designed to detect what is nourishing and what is toxic, and what being able to move towards what is nourishing and being able to move away from what is toxic. So this very immediate of liking, disliking, pleasant, unpleasant, or neutral, this is something that's built into our system. So here, the Buddha says that awareness of that is actually one of the direct paths to freedom. This is one of the direct paths to liberation. And he begins in the sutta with asking the question, and how, monks, does one in regard to feeling tone abide contemplating feeling tone? And he goes on and says, here, when a pleasant feeling, he knows I feel a pleasant feeling. When feeling an unpleasant feeling, he knows I feel an unpleasant feeling. When feeling a neutral feeling, he knows I feel a neutral feeling. So this is something that goes on for us all the time, and it's sort of an immediate call out. And we may not even really recognize it, but when we begin to look for it, we can see how it is. And for example, if I say the following sort of sentences, you can just try to notice what's happening in your own system, what happens on your own inner screen, and try to imagine it. So the smell of freshly baked bread, a baby smiling, the smell of a drain, newly cut grass. So just try to see, when you hear this freshly baked bread, the smell of that, just try to see if there is an immediate call out of either something pleasant or something unpleasant. For many people, it will be pleasant, but not for everybody. So for some, for example, if you are gluten intolerant, it may not have a pleasant feeling tone. The same with the smell of a drain. When we bring that to mind, many of us will also feel that we have an immediate reaction to it, that we can immediately know if we feel that it's pleasant or if we feel that it's unpleasant. So this is sort of an immediate call out that is with us all the time, that is with us moment by moment by moment. And if we look at our own body right now, we may see that also. And indeed, there may be some of you who were noticing this also as we were sitting practicing before. That how at any given moment in the body, there may be some sensations, there may be something that's pleasant, there may be something that's unpleasant. So the question really is, why is this feeling tone so important? And why is the Buddha talking about it? He's talking about it in the Satipatthana Sutta, but he's also talking about it many other places. And it's said that this being mindful of feeling tone is one of the master keys that reveals and unlock the deepest patterning of our conditioning. So before we were talking about how this not really seeing our own qualities, not seeing our own preciousness, how this is something that's related to a patterning, related to a conditioning. It's because we have learned to look in other directions. We're not really trained in seeing it. So we can see how it can be really important to have a key to unlocking our own conditioning, to have a key to unlocking our own patterning. And we will see this feeling tone, how it's related to conditioning. We can see that in our own experience in many different ways. I remember a time when I was having a sore throat and I was drinking a lot of tea with honey in it. And I got better and some months passed. And then I was visiting somebody and they served me a cup of tea with honey in. And I just remember taking it up and smelling it and experiencing unpleasant, right? So there was an example of how there was a conditioning, a recent conditioning that had changed my experience so that before what would normally be pleasant, all of a sudden now because of this conditioning, now it was unpleasant. So feeling tone is not something that is given. It's not something that is in the object. It's something that's in our own mind, and it can change. We can never know exactly what it is, even though, of course, there are trends, but it can change. So we can think about also how if we eat ice cream, how maybe the first mouthful of ice cream can be experienced that's pleasant. But we could also imagine that if we're not allowed to stop eating ice cream, how what was before pleasant will be something that actually gives rise to something that's unpleasant. So it's both in the feeling tone, we both have our past condition, very remote condition, and more recent conditioning. And it's because of the link to our conditioning that it can be so valuable to understand it and to see what's actually going on. And again, it's important for us to begin to see how it's a quality in our own mind. And this is where we often make the mistakes because we expect or we interfere that the feeling tone arises from the object, that it's in the object, that it's the ice cream that's pleasant or it's the honey that is pleasant. But actually, it's something that is arising in our own mind when there's the contact with the different sense objects. So feeling tones can arise at any of the six sense doors. So it can be through seeing, through hearing, to tasting, to touch, and so forth. But it can also arise to something in the mind that's happening in the mind. And so one of the classical examples from the Buddha is the story about the two darts, or the sutta about the two darts, and which is really speaking to how there is first maybe a painful sensation, there's something that's arising. And then afterwards, if we are not mindful, then we have our own reactivity. We have either aversion, dislike, if it's something that's painful, if it's something that's pleasant, then we can have the grasping, the wish to hold on. We have the wish for something to continue. And so when we begin to see how it's not in the object, then we also begin to have the courage. That's where we begin to have a little bit of courage, where we can begin to have a closer look to what it is that's happening inside us. And I remember a situation where I was in a conversation with another person, and this person said something to me about me. And the person said, "I feel you're always holding back a little bit. And I felt that since the first time I ever met you." And I remember, you know, hearing that, how I was freezing in that moment, and how it almost felt as if my mind and body separated. And also I could see how my mind got ready to get defensive, you know, thinking that, oh, this is actually really cheap to say this because I've already said that this is one of my patterns, but also how my body, you know, got numb. Right. So this would be sort of my reactivity response for the body to get more numb. So this preparedness to get caught in reactivity. But I also remember in this situation, for whatever reason, then there was also a little bit of space. And I could see and I could feel the unpleasantness. And I could see that it was also my learning history. And so I think what is really interesting, when we begin to be able to see the Vedana, when we begin to be able to see the feeling tone, and we have a little bit of space, then we also begin to see our own learning history. And so we begin to see, not to take it so personally, to in that moment, without it sort of a very intellectual understanding where we add things up and say, oh yeah, this must be it. But there's this sort of immediate understanding of, yes, this is also conditioned. And when we begin to see that, first of all, there is awareness, isn't it? So there's something that makes it possible for us to see that. That's awareness. But there's also compassion. Because this, when there's a space to see that, it's not being seen in a cold space. It's actually being seen in a space that has compassion, that has warmth. So we immediately, when we move away from focusing on the object, focusing on what somebody said or whatever, to the unpleasant feeling tone, then we also see that there is an atmosphere of compassion within that quality of awareness. And we also immediately get access to wisdom. So one of them, there's a wisdom in understanding conditions and how, you know, how every moment is conditioned. There's a wisdom that is available in those situations also, where we also see, a moment before I was okay, now an unpleasant feeling tone arose. So we begin to see, we get access to the wisdom of change, to the wisdom of impermanence. So this is something that we can see. So for me, one of the things that beginning to work very intentionally with feeling tone, because it's not just a cold knowing, but it also has this built-in, we could say there's a built-in joy that comes with being able to be in the present moment, to be aware also of whatever it is that's unpleasant. And there's this natural compassion that is present when there's something that is painful. And when we see how our own suffering is constructed, so we immediately also have a doorway to compassion. And then there is this wisdom that it doesn't have to be this way, and that there is the possibility of change. So I think I will stop here and just maybe hear if you have any comments, any thoughts, any reflections that you would like to share. And maybe we can ask Mani also if there's anything in the chat that would be good to repeat here.
In the chat, we did have some questions just about citing the resources. Mm-hmm. I found something related, but I think maybe you would be able to guide us better.
Yes, so I was citing this one, the Dhammapada, Jill Fonsdale's translation, chapter 12.
Thank you. Emma's mind has been blown. In the best way possible, she says, thank you. Anyone who wants to come on directly or just unmute, you could raise your digital hand, and then we will be able to call on you.
Yeah, so there's a comment from Emma saying, one thing I've realized is that when you see the source of compassion within yourself, you can also see that source of compassion in others' actions as well. Yes, this is one of the really, really beautiful things, isn't it? That when we see it in ourselves, it becomes a natural bridge also to see it in others. And this is where practice is changing our perception, isn't it? So that this is what we begin to be looking for, this. And then once we begin to look for it, then we begin to be able to see it more and more. So it completely changes our perception, not just of ourselves, but it also changes our perception of others. And with that change in perception, there's a lot of other things that are following also, isn't there? Because really, you know, a lot of our struggle and a lot of our suffering is coming from that sense of not being in touch with what we would like to be in touch with, not seeing how we embody some of the qualities that we would like to have in our life. So that's where the loneliness, that's where the hollowness, that's where the sense of separation, it's all rooted in that. And once we begin to see that within ourselves, then we also see it in others, then that's a way where some of these walls are coming down. And this from Ilka, I'm particularly sitting with this piece, don't give up your own welfare for the sake of others' welfare, however great. Clearly know your own welfare and be intent on the highest good. So that's another quote from the Dhammapada. Yeah.
Okay. So there's a question.
How can we cultivate compassion for those who harm us? Yeah, that's a good question, isn't it? And it's a challenging question, isn't it? So I would say, you know, that different levels of compassion. So that there's one level of compassion where we have compassion. Let's say I hurt my knee, right? So then I can have compassion, or somebody can have compassion because I'm hurting. And there's a level of compassion where we begin to see that we begin to have compassion actually with our own lack of understanding. We begin to have compassion with the lack of knowing that leads to so much suffering. So that's a different level of compassion. So when it comes to people who are harming us, it's of course very, very important to take care of ourselves, right? So having compassion for someone doesn't mean that we just allow people to do and continue with whatever actions that they may be taking that are harmful to us or that are harmful to others. So compassion doesn't mean that we become passive. But I think the process really is starting with ourselves and seeing if we can see underneath everything that I do, then there is really compassion. There is really the wish to be free of suffering. There is really the wish to be happy. So we look at that in our own situation again and again and again until we really come to a firm ground that, yes, even in my most confused moments, when the result is something very different, I can actually see that this is where it came from. And then we do the same investigation with others, right? And so it's out of that understanding that it's rooted in confusion. It's rooted in not understanding. So it doesn't mean that we don't set limits. It doesn't mean that we accept everything. But if we do this kind of investigation, then we can begin to see that even the most confused people in situations where they are creating a lot of suffering, it's actually coming out of a wish for them to be well, to be safe, to whatever, feel good in that moment. So it's rooted in that. It doesn't mean that the action is okay. But there's something in doing this investigation slowly, slowly, gradually, gradually, until we really come to a firm ground where we can say, I've looked again and again, I've looked with people who were myself, with people who were close to me, people I love, I've looked with neutral people, and I've looked with people whom I also have difficulties with. And this is the same that I've found again and again. Yeah, there's a hand.
Thank you for your talk. If you could repeat that quote in the beginning,
no.
Appreciate it, but I also have a question.
Yeah.
I think it has to be regarding with the self, with the unpleasant, impression, neutral, the feeling tone that comes when you, you know, you live the life of like not being able to, you know, being able to break from codependency relationships, you know, and you're trying to tell myself, yeah, you deserve a partner now. Like you deserve to feel safe with someone and trust someone again in a safe way. And my guard always goes up, but I notice that my body contract, so you don't try to hold a hand or get closer to that person. I do it slowly. I guess I call it modern coding now. So it's need someone slow, very slow. But I do notice my body going back to the safety, right? Like a slight response almost, I feel sometimes. Okay, I'll be like, that's enough. That's it, no more. Like, I'm going to take a pause again. So I don't know where, I know, kind of know, I'm aware where it's coming from. And I'm trying to get a sense of feeling safe again in me so I can proceed. Then I get stuck.
Yeah, so thank you so much for bringing that up. And I think it's certainly something that probably resonates with me and probably also with many others, right? Because this is one of the situations where we see our own learning history, isn't it? But actually seeing it is a major step, because often we wouldn't even see it. We would just go with the story, whatever it may be, that I cannot do this, or this is not for me, or whatever it is. So then we just go with the story, and then we act on that, and then that becomes our life. But if we begin to actually to turn towards and to know the unpleasantness, so even though we see that, yeah, we are, you know, it's conditioned, but we begin to turn towards the unpleasantness and to know it, just know it for what it is. In that moment, as I was talking about, then there is awareness, there's mindfulness. And with awareness, with mindfulness, there's a little bit of space. And in this little bit of space, there is also some warmth. There is also some compassion. So we don't need to sort of dictate what we should do. I should move on, or I should not do. We don't need to do that. If we just in that moment can see it and allow that natural compassion to be there, and that natural wisdom, which is the understanding that this is, you know, this is conditioned, this is my learning history, but also that it's not fixed. Everything is changing, everything is moving. So one moment before I was okay, now I have this contraction. This too can change. If we can be with that and allow that to move, then there's the opportunity that we can begin to move towards rather than move away from, right? So the reactivity is broken, and that's really what we're looking for, so that we begin to have a little bit more freedom.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And please share that quote from the beginning that you wrote.
It
was really
dense. It says, if one knew oneself to be precious, one would guard oneself with care. The sage will watch over herself in any part of the night.
Okay.
Mani, anything from the chat?
Unless I'm missing something, I do think this is really a resonance for what you've been sharing and reiteration of some of the points you've made.
Okay, good.
There's one. Beth says, can you say more about ignorance and confusion?
Yeah. So this is why I love this quote so much. Because this quote is suggesting that if we really could see ourselves, if we knew ourselves to be precious, then we would act with mindfulness. So the confusion is that we don't see ourselves, we don't see our qualities, we don't really know ourselves in the right way. So when we don't do that, then it also have implications for, you know, for how, what we do. And so that's when, if we have a diamond, but we don't know we have a diamond, we think we're poor, then we will act in that way. So it's really this confusion that is the root of a lot of suffering. And so getting to know ourselves, getting to spend time with ourselves like we do when we sit down on the cushion and really look into our own minds and into our own hearts and really see ourselves, that's a way out of confusion. When we don't really, and it's not just seeing ourselves as precious, but it's also seeing others as precious, seeing life as precious. So again, like we talked about before, it's not limited to ourselves, but it also has implications for how we see others. So we could say if we don't see, you know, the natural world as precious, what happens? And if we see the natural world as precious, then we would also act with mindfulness and with care. If we see others as precious. And again, it's not that this is not the case. When we do a thorough investigation and really look, then that's actually what we see. When we really look at our own life, our own situation, and our own qualities, we don't end up with the firm conviction that we are lacking, we're failures. We actually come to the firm conviction that we see how beautiful we are and how hard we have. We're all trying, and all the good qualities that we possess. So there's one who's asking for the link, for donation link.
I can drop that in now. 1 second.
Jessica.
Hi. Thank you for this. I feel like I have to go back and hear the recording again and again to get it kind of through my head. But one of the things I struggle with is I have an intellectual understanding of what you're talking about. And I'm even sort of getting to the point in my practice where I can realize that it's not the object, but the Vedana comes from my perception of it and this conditioning. But I think because of the conditioning, I have such shame around so many things that it gets hard to move. And then because it's not moving, I get, you know, I start clinging to the wanting it to move and things like that. So, and it's just really upsetting. Like, I mean, it's just tough. So I'm just wondering if you have any, whether it's in practice or just in life, how to sort of move from that, how shame kind of sticks us in a spot.
Yeah. Thank you for bringing that up also. Yeah, you know, so And shame is very sticky, isn't it? So, and it's already the next step from after Vedana, after the immediate call out of pleasant or unpleasant or neither, then depending on our reactivity, then shame can be activated. But at any given moment, we can be aware of the Vedana. So one of the things we can be aware of when shame is there, we can be aware of it as unpleasant. So when we focus on the shame itself, the emotion of shame, then we also have what it is that is triggering it, right? So that's drawing us more into the story. But if we can just be aware of it as unpleasant, and then with the unpleasantness, also again, then when there's the knowing of the unpleasantness, then there's also an atmosphere of compassion. So this goes together, that there is, when there's this knowing, this is unpleasant, then there's also, compassion is already there. Not as a compassion to change things, but there is already this atmosphere. And then the best we can, we stay with, we just acknowledge that. And allow ourselves to know that, yes, I don't need to like this. It's okay that I don't like it. It's okay that it's unpleasant. So I'm not making myself wrong, right? It's all these causes and conditions and that has all brought to this arising in this moment. But I don't need to like it. I don't need to. It's okay that I don't like it. And it's this acceptance of this is the way it is. I don't need to like it. And the compassion that's naturally there that allows a little bit more space for it to also move. And then another feeling tone will arise. And maybe that's also unpleasant. And then something comes in, arises in the mind, a memory, another thought, and maybe that's also unpleasant. So of course we can have this chain of different feeling tones, but they happen moment by moment.
I was going to, as a follow-up in terms of Vedana, I have this experience where like if I have an unpleasant Vedana, almost quickly it moves to neutral, and maybe mm-hmm. then recognize the neutral then to pleasant because of the recognition, right? Mm-hmm. So sometimes Vedana is tough because like it seems to move so quickly, and because you like what you're saying, that the awareness itself is pleasant, you know, or you know, the compassion or something. So that's a strange thing that happens too, I guess, around that.
Yeah. And especially in our practice, if we think we need to get all of them, then we can get very busy, right? So we don't need to be sort of try to get all of them, but we can just be with some and just see how rapidly it changes. And this seeing how rapidly it changes is already creating more flexibility, right? Because we get in accordance with impermanence, we get in accordance with change. So this, all this stuckness of just being in one way, that's gradually being loosened. All right, so I think we
are at time. There is a question about how can people find your teachings? Where else do you teach that they can find you? I said Bodhi College and the Insight Meditation Society, but I didn't know if you wanted to give people a reference there.
Yeah, I do. I do some things for Bodhi College. I do some things for Gaia House.